In the previous video, I assembled the enclosure and mounted all the major components on an aluminium panel. And in this video, I will finish wiring the power supply unit, the variable frequency drive, stepper drivers and control board to their relevant power sources. The first thing I need to do is make a mounting panel for the on and off switch and the emergency stop. I was planning to do this on the CNC machine, but it will be a lot quicker for now just to make these by hand. I can file or drill a small notch on the edge of the plates to clamp them in place between a machine screw and nut. Okay, I've cut out this bit of perspex. It's a opal light box acrylic. It's the same stuff that I used to do the Blade Runner lampshade, so it's matte on one side and glossy on the other. I've decided to use the matte side, and I've mounted the two components, the on and off switch and the emergency stop. I may end up using clear acrylic in the end if the innards are worth showing off, but I also like the idea of these opal panels being backlit by the LEDs from within. I'm now fitting the glam, which will bring power into the enclosure. I'm going to see a little notch there that I'm using just to hold it in place for now. I've gone and wired everything up as I had done in part 9, but ran into a problem. Okay, so I've just turned the power on and the light is on. Just gonna flick that up. Okay, I've wired something incorrectly. Shit. I thought I was going crazy again, and so I bought another two switches. I got a refund for the one I had before, and they're all the same, even the ones with a different face to them. And I thought maybe I've completely misunderstood this. So I kind of googled electrical contacts, and normally open contact pairs open in a non-conductive state. So this one here, the brown side, should not make a noise when I touch them. It does. So I've gone and wired this back up thinking that the other ones were correct without actually checking them. Again, I didn't even take my advice from the previous video. The designer must have decided to put labelling on the plastic moulding of these switches, but failed to mention that to whoever was assembling. That's my theory anyway. The e-stop doesn't have any labelling, so you have to use a voltmeter to check which terminal is normally open and which is normally closed. Once I was happy with the wiring between the breaker, contactor and switches, I began crimping the ends of the wires with forked ends. The blue ones have a larger inner diameter hole and can be used to crimp two wires together, while the red ones are for a single 1mm wire. This method of terminating the wires looks neater and should also prevent flakes of copper dropping off into the enclosure in case any break loose.
I need to screw the barrier block down now.
I had to screw this terminal barrier block down to the panel mount while other components were in place. This wasn't ideal, and I hope I haven't made problems for myself to come. I'm going to use this block to split the power, neutral and earth wires over 6 terminals, making it easier to access.
If the terminal crimp is a bit too long to get into the terminal, what I do is bend the metal a little bit, and that normally means I can feed that in.
In retrospect, this entire section would have been a lot easier to install had I got terminals and an EMI filter which could fit onto a longer DIN rail.
So I'm just going to put the EMI filter in now.
The spacing in this section is quite cramped, so I had to line up the terminals on the EMI filter against the slots in the trunking.
I think it's pretty clear I'm not an electrician. I think if you're in doubt about anything, you should always talk to someone who as a qualification. I know there's a sort of trend at the moment of rejecting experts, but the truth is, this is just one example where you do it at your own peril, quite frankly. I was going to put shielding on this, I did, and then I went to have a look at what other makers have done and noticed that they didn't use shielding on the power cable coming in, so I'm going to ignore that part. The in-my filter is fitted between the power and neutral wires coming out of the contactor unit and then towards the power input on the VFD. The earth on the EMI filter is wired to the terminal block. I just wired the power, earth and neutral to that EMI filter. I'm just going to pop these into the appropriate end. The earth is already on the barrier block. I had found two earth terminals inside the VFD, which from further inspection were connected to the aluminium heatsink on the rear of the variable frequency drive. I'm not sure if this was the correct thing to do, but I also connected the earth wire from within the VFD to the barrier block. I probably could have found a barrier block and an EMI filter that could have fitted onto a rail, which would have made this a bit easier to space out. I think it is a little bit to one side, but it works. So that's a relief, a massive relief. I'm now wiring power to the final components within the enclosure. I already soldered the DC power jack for the control board in a previous video and have cut it to size, running it from the 24 volt power supply via the e-stop's normally closed switch. In case of emergency, I can press the emergency stop, which opens the contact and stops power reaching the control board. I also wire the 36 volt DC power from another power supply unit to the stepper motor drivers. So I've just put two wires in onto one terminal. I use blue fork crimps to connect two sets of wire from one set of terminals to power two of the drivers. So all four drivers use two sets of power and ground terminals on the PSU. Turn this back on again. The green lights are turning on. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. So that's power coming into all the major components, the variable frequency drive, all the power supply units, the drivers, and the control board. In the next video, I'll wire the stepper motor drivers to the aviation panel mount and the control board. Everything seems to be coming together well, but I have to admit, deciding to only use two machine screws to hold the external panel mount means there's a little flex there. I can't change the enclosure now, so I'll have to think of a solution to reduce this in a future video. Anyway, if you found this video useful and or enjoyable, please sacrifice a thumb. And if you can financially support this channel, please check out my Patreon page, the link to which can be found in the description. Their subscribers can access additional material, and in the case of this part of the project, a diagram of the wiring so far. Thanks again for watching.